And the clock is running.
Hey.
So introduce the show, Andy.
Hi, and welcome to Frame by Frame. I'm Andy, and to my right is Stephen. Happy birthday, Stephen.
Hello, Andy.
Hello.
I'm Stephen.
Stephen hates people when it's his birthday. He doesn't want people to talk about it.
I'm all right.
Doesn't like a fuss being made of him, do you, mate?
No, I'd rather just get in a car, drive to the ocean, and just stare out at the ocean and leave it all behind.
Mm.
But I don't drive and I don't have a car. So
we just think here, two people in Manchester be talking about something. Over in Los Angeles, Mark Maron has talked to the president.
Racism, we are not cured of.
Clearly.
And it's not just a matter of it not being polite to say nigger in public. That's not the measure of whether racism still exists or not. It's not just a matter of overt discrimination. We have societies don't overnight completely erase everything that happened 200 to 300 years prior.
He's still kicking himself going, oh my God, did that happen? But that was astonishing. It has been brewing for a while, though. But everybody thought it was going to be like it was just it was never going to happen.
Still not up.
Because I think he was trying to get you know, during the elections a couple of years ago, he was trying to get Hillary Clinton. He was trying to get all those candidates. I reckon there's probably, you know, from the moment they finished
this episode of WTF. Whoa. Featuring President Barack.
Sorry.
I'm guessing also that he eliminated any of the what the fucks, because
yeah,
in the episode announcing that he was going to be doing the president, he says I can't do any of the and I think that, yeah, if you're going to be having if the president's going to have that as a representation of his of an interview, and a popular one at that,
yeah,
he's probably going to say you're going to have to cut out your you know, your WTF, you're not what the fuck today, okay?
Yeah,
you're talking to the president.
Barack Obama, bloody hell.
But that's that I won't mind. I mean, I'm sure he wouldn't mind even. It doesn't matter. But I think the editing process on that episode for him, if like, can I keep this? Can I keep that?
Yeah, I reckon when they edited it, it would have been over. Overseen by somebody else as
they
well.
Edit, send it over.
Because usually I wake up in the Monday morning and I have a WTF ready to listen to, but yeah, this has only just come up now.
So it's just, yeah, a little bit of a delay, and I reckon they've been working through it through the night, through the yeah, weekend, to get that out. It's a big episode, and it's like, well, where can you go with that? I mean, Mark Maron is doing so well now, and yet he's still so modest. I mean, the beauty, and I noted it in a post on Facebook, that it's like, it's, you know, everybody's been making points about, you know, why didn't you shave? Why didn't you put on some nice clothes? Why didn't you tidy up the garage? It's a human being having another conversation with another human being.
Yeah.
You don't, there's no pomp, there's no, you know, prestige. You don't put out red carpets. You just let the guy come in and have a conversation about being human.
Yeah.
And that's what he's breaking new ground, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so.
You tell me wherever Barack Obama has gone and they've actually gone put on ceremony.
But it's part of that, and part of Barack Obama is so trying to be the cool kid. You know, he's turned up in Between Two Ferns.
Yes, he has.
He was,
yeah,
on that,
he was on,
you know,
that,
and
yeah,
you're kind of like, oh, he's on.
But
what you doing?
I think that's kind of what they have to do now. I mean, there's imagine Nixon trying to be the cool kid. Yeah, so tell us about the what was it, Scandinavian movie? No.
Oh, the Serbian film.
So David Cameron, would you like to watch the Serbian film?
Yeah, we could do a video, make him watch it, and then his reaction to it.
I just imagine. But yeah, I wouldn't want to. I mean, the only politician I would like to actually interview, because it's fun, Boris Johnson.
Yeah,
I think everybody calls him a buffoon and a goofball, but I think he's the most accessible politician.
Yeah,
of our generation, and I think he still does a good job.
I've got a soft spot for Ann Widdecombe.
Have you?
Yeah.
What's that about?
Don't know. Well, partly because she's a virgin. She's still a virgin. And I just think that'd be a real nice surprise for the suicide bombers. You know what I mean?
That's a good one. That's nice.
But did you hear the exciting news?
What's the exciting news?
They're going to make a remake of Big Trouble in Little China.
What?
With Dwayne The Rock Johnson playing Jack Burton.
Why is it that whenever we wanted do a podcast on something, there's news about, or they've actually just made it. It's like Amityville.
Yeah.
Not Amityville. Enfield.
Enfield Poltergeist.
Enfield Poltergeist. Well, we went two directions there, and but yeah, they're always remaking stuff. It's just Remake City.
Yeah.
But why is that?
The thing is like, I love Big Trouble in Little China. Partly because Kurt Russel is just like a buffoon in it. He's not. He's like.
He's trying to be
this macho guy, yeah. But he just keeps getting things wrong.
He's chewing everything.
He makes mistakes. Like the part where it's actually on now at the minute. And he makes that war cry and shoots his gun in the air, and then he shoots the masonry off the ceiling. It hits him and knocks him out. You know, it's just beautiful.
It is.
Yeah, that guy in that big suit tries to kill him, and he puts his dagger in his foot, and the guy lunges on him, and his dagger goes into him and he kills the guy. But then all of a sudden, he's just stuck with him on top of him, and he's too heavy to get him off, and he can't move, you know.
He adds a bit of realism to the martial arts film, I think.
Yeah, like, can you imagine The Rock being in that?
I don't understand The Rock being in that role. You're right. It's Yeah, I mean, who would you prefer to be in that role if they were going to remake it?
If they had to remake it,
Kurt Russel.
Kurt Russel, yeah. who
bring him back?
Who could do that now? Who could be
Chris Pratt?
Yeah, Chris Pratt.
He
maybe.
Seems to be able to do everything that at the moment. Chris Pratt. He's got the finger on the pulse of the filmmaking world.
Yeah. He's so hot right now.
He's, but he was on. Was it? I think it was Kimmel, and they was talking about.
They're good friends.
They're good friends. And he says, "Well, so tell us, when are you gonna do Indiana Jones?
You're gonna play Indiana Jones next, yes?"
Thank you. Interesting. I don't remember.
I thought I'd throw that out there.
Well, I don't know. Like, you know, I don't know. This movie is the point. Look, to get to your question, Jurassic World opens on June 12th.
Okay, all right. You don't have to answer the question. And
well, I have no answer to it. I don't know. I mean, I missed a phone call. The other day. Unknown number.
It might have been him.
I hope it wasn't him.
And then he just looked at the camera. Everybody cheered. It's like, no. But you look at him, and it's like all of a sudden, Harrison Ford came through. And I'm like, yeah, he could totally do.
He could do it.
And he do it really well.
Yeah.
I think he's the most closest. You know when we had that little spiel last week about icons?
Yeah.
He could very well leap out of that frame if he focused.
Yeah, he's got charisma.
He's got it, yeah.
In the bucket loads.
But he's also got a bit of a dirty edge to him as well.
Yeah, and the fact that he turned 36 yesterday, so he's not young. And he's...
Excuse me? We're young.
No, you know what I mean, though? in Hollywood.
Yeah,
It's usually like...
Zac Efron.
Yeah, early 20s, that's 20. When people start to get... But he's done it at 36.
And that's good.
That's good.
That's good. Well,
and you know, when he was on Parks and Rec, he was fat. He had to lose weight to do Guardians of the Galaxy. You know what I mean? And Zero Dark Thirty was in Zero Dark Thirty. So.
They actually, yeah, and it's amazing. I don't think that method acting is a part of the regime anymore. But I think that was he supposed to be fat in Parks and Recreation?
I think he just was.
That was
he just didn't care. He just ate.
Just really,
and it was just like he got to the point where they offered him the part. James Gunn wanted him for the part, but the studio didn't. But he had to argue the point and said, "Well, if you're going to do it, you're going to have to lose some weight." So
yeah,
he lost the weight.
How come Brad Pitt's not fat? He eats food in every single film.
Yeah,
he
but he probably makes himself sick and works out after this cut.
Okay, retake.
I just need to go to my trailer.
That's what Angelina does. She gets a kick out of it. Come on, let me ram those fingers.
Yeah, that's it. Well,
bring it up.
She's making him gag with one hand and buying African children with the other. On the internet.
So I think we seriously need to transition into our main feature.
But what I was going to say, just before we move on, do you think we run the risk of getting Chris Pratt overload if he's starting to be in everything.
True. I mean, he is.
Because he's going to be in Guardians. He's going to be in other Marvel films now, because I reckon the Guardians are going to join the Avengers and stuff like that. Maybe he's going to be another. Because Jurassic World has been insanely popular. It's done really well. So maybe he's going to do another one of that. He'll be in that. If he's Indiana Jones.
But think about Harrison Ford back in the. I mean, he was in Star Wars.
Yeah.
He was also in Indiana Jones at the same time. He did other films in between that.
He
did a lot. He was the guy who was in every single movie in the 80s, to be honest and to be fair. And I think it's going to be a phase, and then it will just drop off again.
Yeah.
And he'll then go into more meaningful stuff, or just get cranky and become a carpenter. I don't know. Who knows?
Talking of Carpenter. So because we had this news about the remake of Big Brother in China.
Right, so we heard about this.
Yeah, this remake. So we thought, we're both big fans of John Carpenter.
Oh yeah, we are.
Well, maybe we should talk about him and maybe what happened
to him. What happened to him? Yeah, it's an interesting story actually, because I think he's considered a maverick director. He's not associated with the new wave as such, because new wave was about bringing high art movies, but he kept his movies very real.
Yeah,
he was subversive, but he kept his movies kind of low key. He didn't go over the top. They weren't massive budget movies. They weren't Jaws. They weren't Godfather. They were small.
I think
comfortable,
because Big Brother in Little China didn't do Big Trouble in Little China didn't do very well.
Yeah.
I think maybe if it had done really well, maybe he would have started getting off with the big gigs.
Yeah, but that's kind of the interesting thing about him, because he's always kind of been on the same track in terms of the size of his movies have always kind of been. I mean, the reputation has kind of superseded. I mean, Halloween, the reputation is massive.
Well, he's made two of my favourite films of all time.
Yes.
Being Halloween and The Thing.
Two amazing films.
Yeah, perfect films.
But they don't go out of their way to be blockbusters. They went out of their way to just be the films that they are, and everybody's kind of built them up to be great because they are great.
Yeah.
But that's what I like about John Carpenter. He's sparing in his approach, and yet we, the audience, love him.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, just as much as a Spielberg or a Lucas.
It cuts to Lucas. Yeah, so what was his first film? It would have been Dark Star, wouldn't it?
His first film was Dark Star.
Yeah.
It was wrote it with Dan O'Bannon.
Yeah.
I think he helped on the script as well. He was, but it's a comedy.
Yeah, it's just a wacky space cowboy thing, isn't it?
It's one heck of a comedy, though.
Yeah, really bad effects. It's just great.
Yeah. And I think it was a good film for him to get his foot in the water.
Yeah.
I think it was definitely a tongue-in-cheek movie. But it's a good movie to learn your craft.
Absolutely.
Special effects weren't his thing back then, though, on that film.
Definitely. They're really bad.
But that's the point. That's the whole point of the film. He wasn't looking to have a Stan Winston. He wasn't having Rick Baker coming in doing all those effects. That wasn't until The Thing.
Yeah. Which we'll get to.
Dark Star just didn't. It had a very small budget.
Yeah.
It didn't have a release.
It feels more like a student film, really.
It does. But I think it was the kind of wacky comedies that were emerging in the 70s.
Because we spoke about this quite a bit. It's very Hitchhiker's.
Yeah.
Came before Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Which ruined your perception of Hitchhiker's in a way.
Who's to say, though, Douglas Adams never watched Dark Star and just had the idea? And it was a radio show before it was ever a book, so who knows?
Yeah, who knows? But yeah, the influences are definitely there.
It does seem like it, definitely. Very surreal. That alien that's just a ball. It's just brilliant.
In a way, it is a kind of a parody for 2001. There is a lot of 2001-isms there, where you can't get into the ship, or he can't stop the nuclear thing from exploding.
Yeah.
He's like, turn it off now. No, I'm not going to do it. Turn it off. I can't remember the lines.
Well, I was reading the quotes yesterday. I was like, I wish I could remember them. Because,
yeah. But it's kind of film that you can watch over and over again. So, after Dark Star, what came about? Feature.
And after that, he did Assault on Precinct 13.
Assault on Precinct 13.
Which is brilliant.
I have seen it, but I don't remember it that much. It's kind of like... It's basically a prison riot, right? It's a...
Yeah, since they've got like a prisoner and they're getting attacked by these unseen guys who are trying to get in there and get this prisoner back. And
right.
It's just really well made, really well done. It's directed impeccably and it's creepy as well. It's very creepy. It's sort of it's got sort of overlays of horror in there, but it's kind of like a western as well with, you know, they're trying to get the prisoner out, and it's just really well made, really well done. Corner of the eye stuff, people just trying to attack out of nowhere, all that kind of stuff, and they're just trying to hold down a fort. Really good film.
Yeah, I mean, he is considered to be a genre director. He likes to fuse genres. I mean, comedy, sci-fi. This sounds like an action. I mean, he likes his action blending with kind of a dark horror, future, imperfect futures. So I'm guessing Assault on Precinct 13 is contemporary.
Contemporary.
It's just now.
Yeah, and because obviously they made the remake of it with Ethan Hawke and Lawrence Fishburne, which is okay.
Yeah,
but it's not nowhere near as. That's the thing with it. It feels fresh when you watch it, even now, with the flared trousers and stuff. It feels fresh and clean and well done and. You know what I mean?
It's kind of like watching Dawn of the Dead movies and those kind of films. They're of the time. They fit in.
It's like watching Halloween.
But it's like going back in time and just watching it back in the day.
Yeah.
And you don't sit there and go watch Halloween and go, my gosh, is this dated?
Hmm.
You go back there and watch it as if it's new.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
And I think that's John Carpenter's allure. He doesn't make things... He never makes dated films. He brings you back there. He pulls you in.
Yeah.
And that's the difference between him.
Yeah, I suppose it feels like... It's of its time, but it feels relevant.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
You can always find something in it that's
I suppose that's an amazing achievement to be able to do as a director, to be able to watch a film that was done 30 years ago and think that's just as good now as it was back then.
Yeah, but I don't think he had an awareness of it. It's just one of those things that his directing did is everything.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you could say that They Live maybe has a bit of a dated feel to it.
Again, though, I think
off the time.
Yeah, I think everything with They Live is very purposefully done.
But it's relevant as well. I mean, the whole putting the glasses on and seeing Obey and all those things.
Consume and...
Yeah, I mean, it's relevant now because we're still doing it.
He was
obviously looking at things very early on before everybody else kind of gotten onto the whole really are we doing this kind of thing. I mean, before
all the politicians, it's supposed to hiding behind masks in what they do, why they lie to us, but make it as in they're actually aliens and
So what was the so going back to Assault on Precinct 13, what was the overriding goal of that movie? Was it just an action film? Was it saying anything?
I'm not sure if it was saying anything, because it was a simple premise of they've got this prisoner, these faceless thugs are trying to get the prisoner out and get and they're trying to hold down the fort. It's simply that
yeah,
and they're on their own, and their ongoing theme is isolation. There's no help coming from anywhere else. They have to hold down the fort, and they've got no one else to help them.
And that comes back with Escape from New York, when Snake actually says, so what you're saying is I'm on my own in there. Well, thank goodness for that. Because I think the characters tend to prefer it. They prefer the isolation.
Yeah.
Because they work better on their own. They're not very good in crowds. They're not very good with a lot of people. I mean, Big Trouble in Little China, trying to rescue all those people. I was saying, Kurt Russel doesn't look comfortable.
No.
Rescuing 15 green-eyed people.
Such a good character, though.
Because so isolation and the idea of working on your own and not having to rely on other people.
This seems to be
a theme.
Isolation, I think, is a theme he comes back to. Because his next film, which is Halloween, one of the best horror films ever made.
it is one of the most profound films because it was set in a place that was relevant to us. I mean, before, horrors had always been, you know, woods, woodlands, houses, creepy houses, houses on mountains, graveyards, you name it. It's all those places that you go to, but John Carpenter brings the horror home.
Yeah, and again, the we spoke about this before, but the idea of this killer that can't be stopped, but there's no reason behind it.
No.
He's just evil, and he wants to kill, and that's it. There's no backstory. He wasn't. He came from a really nice family. You know what I mean?
The only backstory is that the child wants to kill his sister, and that's it.
Yeah, well, in the first Halloween film, you don't know. Oh, well, he kills his sister in that.
Yes.
That great, long, steadicam shot.
Brilliant, yeah.
Yeah, starts outside the house. Then he goes through, you see his sister going with a little kid, and then he's just following him around. It's just brilliant.
You're there, and that
what
was
a great opening
the
to a
master
film.
Of it. Yeah,
because imagine seeing that for the first time. You don't know anything about it. You know it's about Halloween. It was called Halloween. You know it's about a murderer, but you don't know anything about it. And then you see that last shot where they take the mask off, and it's just a child stood there with a knife.
Yeah,
and it just pans back slightly, and he's just looking to the camera, cold dead eyes. Wow.
And it's one of those strange things where what happens in the scene from that point when we're pulling back, it's divisive. There's no panic happening between the parents. They're just standing there in disbelief.
Yeah.
There's no movement. It's literally the life has just suddenly stopped for everything, and we're just still moving back.
There's all like the
police
and all that going on.
There's a lot of omnipotence. Yeah. The thing about John Carpenter, he gets right into the character's point of view, but then he puts right next to that this grand pullback of what we've just been actually experiencing, and looking at things from a more omnipotent position. He's very good at kind of slicing the two points of view together,
yeah,
for effect.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I think it's great. It's great.
Halloween is just staggering.
It's staggering, but then if you think about it now, in terms of what the film is, it's a film about a killer who is stalking babysitters in a suburban area. The premise is so easy, but it's all about the execution. And so many people have tried to remake that, and tried to do the same thing, and they fail because they only ever achieve this is just somebody stalking people in a situation.
Yeah,
they don't go beyond it
because it's not the first slasher film. There were slasher films before it, but it was the first one that really it created a genre of film.
Yeah, it felt right.
You know, obviously we had all the Friday 13th come after it and things like that, which I like Friday 13th films, but again, he does have a backstory.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? For the first film, it wasn't even Jason; it was his mum.
Yeah,
which was interesting because the people looking after didn't look after her kid. Let him drown, so she's killing the ones that should have been looking after the kid. Then at the end, you got this weird thing where this boy comes out of the lake and pulls her back in.
Yeah.
So the next one, then it's Jason, but who's avenging the death of his mum? So there you go, backstory. And with them, you don't really need much of a story. Or you need two things: lots of deaths and boobs.
Yeah, and here it was kind of like it was not necessary unless it was actually in the scene itself. I mean, the idea of you know, if you're going to have sex, you're going to die.
Yeah, that's the loss of innocence.
Yeah, but it's not
the
as
death
if,
of that
but
part.
They weren't parading it. They weren't parading it for excess or for no reason.
What was the interesting thing with Halloween? There's no blood in it.
No,
there's no blood in Halloween.
There's just agonizing deaths, and that's it.
You know what I mean?
And the very quick deaths as well. There's no kind of.
Yeah, you get a girl who's strangled in a car.
Yeah.
But it's just the. It's Mike Myers in that first film is not attached to life. It's just something. Going on again. It's the fact that he is just this murderer. He's just he just wants to kill. There's no reason behind it, and the reason why you. Like that part where he lifts up that guy with glasses on and then just puts a knife into his chest.
And then just looks at him.
And then just looks at him and his head's moving from side to side, just staring at it.
Yeah, it's just a fascination. And it's, you just watching it and thinking, what is going on?
And the little things, the menace where he's just stood at the pathway in front of them as they're walking up, and then he just moves and then he's gone.
Look where?
Behind the bush.
I don't see anything.
The guy who drove by so fast, that one you yelled at.
Oh, subtle, isn't he? Hey, creep. Laurie, dear.
He wants to talk to you.
He wants to take you out tonight.
Standing in the laundry,
amongst all the washing, and just staring up at her.
Yeah, they're iconic moments, and it's that was the most unnerving part, was the fact that he was just watching and waiting, and then knowing full well that, you know, he's gonna come after you. That's the terrifying thing.
What's the boogeyman?
As a matter of fact, it was.
There you go, Halloween. Elvis TV movie. Was that the one with
Kurt Russell played Elvis, didn't he?
Yeah, so it's a John Carpenter film. So he did a few departures. That might have been an interesting thing to do, because that seems to be a film that is, it's biographical.
Again, sorry, Halloween. Isolation.
Oh, sorry, yeah.
You know, we talk about this theme of isolation. He's coming back to it. Where she's running away from him. She just got out of that house where she found all the dead bodies, and she's knocking on the neighbour's door.
Yes.
And the light switches on, she looks out, and she's like, help me, help me. And she just closes the curtain, switches the light off. Doesn't help her. You know what I mean? That, again, is... that's a good statement to saying that she's on her own. Your neighbours, who you live with, aren't going to help you.
Yeah.
Isolation, she's on her own.
But it's one of those things that people say, that if you scream help in a situation in life, then... the chances are nobody's actually going to help you.
Mm.
You scream fire, everybody will come running with buckets.
At least once a week, the fire alarm goes off at one of the houses across the road from us.
Uh-huh.
No one ever goes to check it.
Yeah,
it's like, oh, that's going off again. One of these times, it'll be a fire.
That'll be wolf. That's the whole wolf thing. But what I'm saying, you know, if someone suddenly came running around screaming fire, knocking on your door saying, fire, fire, help me, then you'd be inclined to help them. But if they came running to the door screaming, saying, help, help, then you're thinking, this is something that I don't want to get involved with.
Yeah.
Fire is something else. Fire is saving the house, and there's no danger to yourself. You just have to...
But that's the thing, that if a neighbour
knocked
on the door at night time screaming for help, and you know the person, you'd let them in.
Yeah, you would.
If it was a stranger, you'd be like, no.
But it's also that maybe we're looking at the idea of American being a nation of paranoia.
Maybe.
And
it's the lynching, white picket fence. What's actually going on in the neighborhood?
What's
stuff?
Really going on? Yeah, everybody wants to say that they're all looking after each other. That all Christian looking after each other's neighbors and being a good person.
A good community.
The community, but really underneath, it's just you never know. You never know. It's very, very much Lynchian.
Yeah.
Very Desperate Housewives. They should have had a serial killer in Desperate Housewives. That would have been fun.
Yeah, murder them all. Cal McLaughlin should have done it.
Yes. Makes sense.
Yeah. So I suppose the big film after that would have been The Fog.
This is K.A.B. Antonio Bay. Stevie Wayne here,
and let me be the first to wish Antonio Bay a happy birthday. We're 100 years old today.
And keep a watch out for that fog bank heading in from the east.
The Fog is his next big genre piece.
Yeah. Again, it's deals with isolation.
Yes.
The
woman on the radio station, the girl who gets picked up by a hitchhiker.
Who does have sex, but doesn't die.
Ah. Then you got the priest, who's barricading himself.
Yeah.
So everybody's in their room, form of isolation somewhere.
Yeah. and essentially the fog just brings these dead fishermen
to the shore. To the shores. It brings the ghosts of the dead fishermen. They're all ready.
Which
to,
again, really creepy. You know, just the white eyes, the light come from the eyes, and then it's just a silhouette apart from that. Very creepy. He does the guy coming out of the shadows really well. Like with the Halloween, where she, you know, she's lying back against the doorway and she's gathering her breath, and he just appears from behind her. So creepy.
Yeah,
it happens a lot in The Fog.
The last time that the latest film that we saw that had that was It Follows.
Yeah, which is essentially a homage to John Carpenter.
Very much so.
Yeah.
An homage to the whole 80s horror. But with The Fog, there's no kind of sense of there's no kind of sense of community or suburb. It's kind of like everything's kind of fractured. You've got a trucker coming in, you've got a woman who's in the lighthouse doing a radio show. Sydney Wade?
Yeah, I think it's Sydney Wade.
They
sort of took her
Scream,
but didn't they get her name from that?
Yeah, was that? Oh,
maybe, who knows.
And then you've got the church, but and the fishing area.
Yeah.
But everything else is kind of like just dark, you know. It's all there's a gas station, I think.
Mm.
It's all dark. It's not really. There's not a lot of daylight in The Fog.
No.
It's all runs for the whole night, isn't it? Just one night. Yeah. So
again,
different
was remade.
It was
fucking terrible. The remake of The Fog is awful.
Yeah. I mean, I think John Carpenter has been remade the most. He is the most remade director.
Yeah,
I can't think of many films now that haven't been, apart from The Escape from New York,
which I think has been talked about.
Yeah,
them doing it.
Yeah, but The Fog remake, I can't understand why people just want to remake these films. It's just a chance to get them to be. To kind of live in the skin of John Carpenter,
yeah,
you know?
Because again, these films really do stand up.
Yeah.
Halloween more so, I suppose, but The Fog, I think you watch it. I get a thing, I think it's called synesthesia, where if you listen to a piece of music or you're watching a film,
you envision
like a colour.
Uh-huh.
It happens when I listen to King Crimson, and when I watch these early John Carpenter films, I get it, where I see like a vibrant blue.
Yeah, The Fog is
blue. It relates to it, The Fog, Halloween, Escape from New York, Assault and Precinct 13,
mm-hmm.
all does that to me.
Yeah, that's fascinating.
Yeah, I think so.
Just a whole, it's a real deep subliminal.
Yeah, it's bizarre.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's interesting, because, you know, no other director really does that. John Carpenter seems to be a man on his own force, and his own force of nature. This ability to kind of tap into you, something that no other director can really, you know, it reaches deep.
Yeah.
But The Fog is again, it's. I think he does his own score for all his films.
He does, but that's what we should have talked about with Halloween.
But still, we can mention it now.
Yeah.
Because I think that was really the first time that the score had become. That homemade score became famous.
Yeah, I think so.
I mean, that's Moby. I mean, I think Moby was inspired by John Carpenter because he knew that John Carpenter made all of the music in his films. So therefore, Moby, the musician, lives by that rule.
Yeah.
He doesn't involve anybody else unless he has to.
Yeah.
And the same with John Carpenter. They all work independently on their own music, and I think that's you're able to be personal with your film.
Mm. And I think the way you used like sort of that 70s synth sound for a lot of it, that sort of influenced a lot of the sounds you get in the like Day of the Dead and things like that. They sort of got enough on influence with that.
Yeah, but nothing that Ridley Scott did for Alien, or James Horner did for Aliens, or all the other films that were going on at the time, they were all just doing the score.
Mm.
John Carpenter was really giving the mood.
Yeah,
the
absolutely.
And putting it into context.
It's menacing and it's foreboding, something creeping on it. Yeah, you know.
It's biological, it's genetic,
yeah.
It's organic. There's something bodily about it, and maybe that's kind of the whole idea, is it gets under your skin more.
Mm.
Yeah.
Fascinating.
Are you a big synth player, or?
Not really. I listen to it, I don't mind it. I can play the theme to Halloween on the piano, though.
You can, very well as well. I can tinker it, but you play it.
But I think part because it's in 7/8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And it's an odd time signature, and it just throws you off a little bit.
Yeah.
And
yeah, because there's a dum, 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 dum.
Yeah.
To do both. And, clever. Yeah, it is a very he's a talented composer.
Yeah.
Even though everybody kind of says, "Oh, he's just playing on a Casio keyboard," yes. He's really playing on a Casio keyboard.
Yeah.
Unlike other people who just do chopsticks.
Yeah.
So
after that, we had Escape from New York.
Interesting film, interesting premise.
Yeah.
New York City is a prison, a penal colony in a way that's isolated from the rest of America.
Yeah.
Filled with convicts. Basically, they live by their own rules.
So this is a dystopia.
Dystopian future.
Yeah. We like the dystopian future.
We do, and I think I've always liked this idea as well. I like the idea of there being an island where convicts are just sent. This is my idea of punishment. You know, you do the crime, you do the time, you get sent to the island, and you get armed with whatever weapon you can pick one weapon.
Yeah.
And there you go, you're dropped off in a knapsack, and that's it. You've got to survive.
It's like Battle Royale mixed with what we did to everyone we sent to Australia.
Yeah, but the Australians built a community, and that's gun.
That's so British, though, isn't it? Let's get all our criminals and send them to paradise.
Send them to paradise. let them. Yeah, I mean that they've got the most patriotic, loving, biodiversity, beautiful country to live in, and it's
yeah.
Like, yeah, what did we do wrong? They should have left them in England, and we should have gone over there.
Yeah,
but that's just classic.
Classic Britain.
But with Escape from New York, it doesn't seem to be that full on violent. The funny thing is, you're not seeing people getting slashed. But the first people that Kurt Russel sees are kind of like just scavengers falling out of manholes and just running around. They turn into animals. So
a very Mad Max type existence.
And that's what I was thinking about when I was watching it last night. I thought, well, is this America's answer to Mad Max? A snake, Mad Max without cars? You know, I can see that they probably could have tried to have made a Mad Max film and actually have cars running around the Arizona desert, and Kurt Russel would have been amazing for that.
Yeah.
But no, they wanted to have that kind of character, but in this particular environment. And the reason for his being there, Snake, why is he sent to New York?
I can't remember.
To rescue the president.
Oh, to rescue the president, which is Donald Pleasence.
Who has crash-landed.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
And the reason they send him?
It's because he's damn good.
He's Snake Plissken.
He's a Snake Plissken.
He's a great character, though.
He is, because he's...
classic character. And the only film that he's ever revisited, really.
It is.
He did the sequel, yeah.
But he's the kind of character that, you know, they literally had to slap him with a death sentence in order to get him to do the job.
Yeah.
You've got 22 hours.
Anti-hero.
Excuse me, but we talked about 24. In 22 hours, the Chinese people are going to do this and that. So they give him a kind of a serum that basically in 22 hours it'll release a toxin in his blood and then he dies. So brilliant setup, because it's motivation. And he's literally motivated to find that president, but it's an odd film, because you kind of expect it to be a really killing zone, kill frenzy zone like Battle Royale, but it's kind of easygoing.
Yeah, got a pimp, got like pimps. Yeah, I was gonna say the pimp in his pimpmobile
with his chandeliers on his. I mean, that's an odd decision. Though. It's like I want to show everybody that I mean business and I own New York City, so I want some lampshades.
Yeah.
Give me some lampshades on my car.
Yeah.
Harry Dean Stanton.
Love that guy. Yeah, I forgot he was in that.
He's in it. And you've got the crazy taxi driver character. It's all, the thing about John Carpenter's films, when he does a Kurt Russel film especially, not when he does a Jamie Lee Curtis so much, the characters are kind of very neutral, easygoing, kind of generic. you know, everyday people.
Yeah.
In a Kurt Russel, John Carpenter film, they're all extremes. They're all caricatures. They're all they can all be in a graphic novel.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, be it The Thing.
Funny you said that, because Escape from New York could have been a graphic novel.
I think they probably have done.
I think they've probably done it afterwards, but I mean, it could have been a graphic novel. Yeah. And then he thought, oh, I'll make a film out of that.
Yeah.
So it's a perfect character. So pulpy, you know. And
it is. It is very much pulpy and very... it's a staggering... I mean, Escape from New York is... It's a fun little romp. I mean, it's a basic premise.
Call me Snake.
Okay, The Thing...
The Thing.
The Thing, right. Talk about Isolation.
Now, first of all, I want to say that The Thing is actually a remake.
Sort of. On The Thing from Outer Space.
Loosely, yeah, because that's one of his favourite films growing up as a kid. His mum used to take
him to fact, the... In fact, aren't they watching The Thing from Outer Space in Halloween? The kids are watching it?
Yeah. That set up the whole premise that people in horror films tend to watch a lot of black and white films. Because they did it in It Follows as well. They watch... B movies,
yeah,
which they don't. Kids don't watch B movies.
Well, I can imagine in the 70s, kids being allowed to watch a horror film.
That's all they had. Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure they were watching The Thing from Outer Space. So it's loosely based on that, but some. What are they? They're sort of scientists, aren't they?
The scientists in the Norwegians are the first. Crew that are out in the, I think, so should we say the Arctic?
Yeah, say
or
the
Greenland.
Arctic.
Let's say somewhere, a very cold place
very
where
cold.
There's lots of ice.
Yeah.
And they're doing some sort of research. You know, they're digging.
Well, we sort of find them, don't we, when they're chasing that dog?
Yeah, the first scene is the dog that's run away from the Norwegian camp, makes its way to the American camp, and the helicopter is.
Yeah.
Is he trying to shoot a dog?
They're trying to kill the dog. They're shooting at the dog.
The Norwegians are.
Yeah. The Norwegians crash and then they start shooting, so they have to kill the Norwegians, don't they? Because they're literally shooting at the scientists.
Yeah, so they're all.
And then
yeah,
we find we're in this sort of science community, again, isolated.
Yeah.
Thousands of miles away from any kind of civilization.
Caricatures all over the place. I mean, they're all very, very specific. Personalities. You've got the big guy with the glasses who says don't trust Clark.
Yeah.
I mean the names. I mean you got McCreary, you got Blair, Knowles, Palmer, Childs, Copper, Norris, Bennings, Clark, Gary, Fuchs, Windows. They've all got kind of just odd names.
Well, this film freaked me out when I watched it, right? Because this was about the time where we got our first VHS player. So my dad would get a film that he thought we'd all enjoy and never really paid any attention to the 18 certificate.
Yeah.
And the scene where the dog's flipping out, all the dogs are going crazy and you go down to it and you see the dog and then all the skin on its face just folds back.
Yeah.
I still find it difficult to watch that bit to this day because I wasn't expecting that.
And
I'm a kid.
The inner child in yourself is still panicked about that. Yeah.
A little bit. I mean, Dad switched it off at that point.
Yeah.
And it freaked me out. It really freaked me out.
Yeah,
and then later on, I went back to bed and Mum and Dad put it on. And I was listening to the part where it was like they were saying that the chances of someone else being infected by this is like 75% or whatever it was. And in my head thought, my mum or my dad could have that in them, and that paranoia stayed with me for a while.
For your whole life, you're still paranoid.
Yeah, they're going to turn into some.
But that's the best kind of feeling I think to get from a film, to actually feel. I mean, that to me is a scarier feeling than any roller coaster could ever give.
Yeah,
a fear that everybody that's around you, one of them could be. This alien,
yeah,
this thing that you can't trust.
The thing that it assimilates you,
yeah,
and it can it could at any point turn into anything from hundreds of planets it's visited,
yeah.
And when you see these horrible things it turns into.
Beautiful creatures.
Oh,
beautiful special effects
in this film is.
It's paradise for the makers who do all those special effects. They literally, I think John Carpenter said, just go crazy.
Yeah.
And I think they did. They just went with it. They thought it. I mean, the tongue that crawls along the floor with their head attached to it.
This is where it turns. And then the thing where it sprouts like legs and starts to walk off.
Yeah.
When the actor is like,
you gotta be fucking kidding.
It's like part of that thing, is that the actor saying that or is that scripted? You know what I mean? Because it's so
real in the moment.
And,
it's real in the moment. It's like, really, I can't believe that this is really happening. All this crazy. I mean,
when they're trying to revive him, and
I just had that vision right in my head as you said it. Yeah.
Yeah, and they got the
defibrillators.
The defibrillator, and then his chest just caved in, and he bites his hands off.
But the guy that they had. That the stunt guy actually had no arms, they didn't cut any of his hands off.
That's the thing, and then he comes up, and then that guy's head just splits open, and then he just that split open head engulfs someone else's head, and he's getting smacked around everywhere.
Yeah.
And...
I know you gentlemen have been through a lot, and when you find the time. I'd rather not spend the rest of this winter tied to this fucking couch!
It's something innately, violently sexual about the whole thing as well. You don't feel it, but because you're overrun by fear and awe.
Mm.
But if you imagine it, this is simply this way of procreating and having coitus.
Yeah.
It's
the sense of what it is. It's assimilating another... Oh, I forgot Bishop was in there. It's simulating something that is sexual.
So it kind of, in a way, society, which also has a very elaborate morphing body shock.
Yeah,
morphing.
Very much influenced, I would say, by the thing.
Yeah.
It's very similar, but more KY.
That was purely about the orgy aspect of it all. And there was literally no gore or horror.
Mm.
It was literally just despicable, distaste, or. Yeah. Kind of disgusting, gross. You feel
a bit there,
but you gotta love that kind of stuff. You gotta love it. It's incredible. I mean, the amount of latex, the amount of silicone, the amount of pasta rubaris, the amount of goo and gunk and guts and the cow innards that they use. They must have had truckloads, gallon loads of all these different things, and they kind of keep adding it.
But it
must
never
have been disgusting. It must have stunk on that set.
But it never loses that sense of complete isolation.
No.
Complete. Again, there's no one to help us.
That's it.
You know what I mean? And that seems to be the core of him as a filmmaker, or at least was.
You the only one who made it?
Not the only one.
Did you kill it?
Where were you, Charles?
Thought I saw Blair. I went out after him. Got lost in the storm. Fire's got the temperature up all over the camp. Won't last long, though.
Neither will we.
How will we make it?
Maybe we should.
If you're worried about me...
If we've got any surprises for each other... I don't think we're in much shape to do anything about it.
What do we do?
Why don't we just wait here for a little while? See what happens.
But I honestly think the thing is just an absolute masterpiece. I don't... It's a perfect film.
I tell you what, it's a film that cannot be staged. It's not one of those films that can be copied, or they remade it. but they didn't do anything with that.
Well, they did a prequel.
They did a prequel, but they didn't do anything.
They did What Happened to the Norwegians.
Yeah, which was kind of soft.
Yeah, CGI heavy.
Yeah, and that's... Yeah, I mean, that's the only reason to remake it, is to kind of go with that craziness, but yeah. But it is definitely one of his best films.
Absolutely, without a doubt. And then after that, there's another film I like.
Christine. Which has got a car in it.
So what do you think of Christine?
It's an odd film, because you don't really expect this to kind of fill out to be a feature.
Yeah.
But it does, and it's done very well.
It's
been a long time since I've seen it, though, so I'm a little shaky on
it. I think in someone else's hands it would have been a lot worse film than it ended up being.
But a lot of adaptations from Stephen King were bad adaptations.
Yeah.
And I think Stephen King, he even says himself that John Carpenter did make the best adaptations of his books.
Really?
So out of all of them, he does prefer his take on the one that he's done a several. I think They Live was also a short story from Stephen King.
Oh, was it?
Yes.
Did not know that.
So, So there is a trust between them.
But yeah, the possessed car.
Possessed car. I mean, it's one step closer to that rubber tire that goes on a killing spree.
Yeah, rubber.
But, rubber.
Great film. Well, it's not great, it's a good film. But yeah, Christine, I thought it's good. It's sort of got a very 50s vibe to it. It's got that song that keeps being played through the car. But it's quite menacing.
When was the last time you saw it?
A while ago. Good for
you. But you've got a good memory of it, so.
Yeah. And the car sort of possesses the kid, doesn't it? The kid becomes really crazy and weird because of this car. And I like the idea of the car getting jealous when he gets a girlfriend. The car's jealous of the girlfriend and kills her.
That's nice. Yeah,
it sort of gasses her
It gasses her out. Doesn't it devour one in the actual engine, on a hot engine?
I'm not sure about that. I don't remember that.
Okay.
But I like how a lot of these films, at the end, it leaves it open to more. At the end of this, because the car gets put into a demolition thing and ends up just being a cube. And at the very end of the film, you just see it bends ever so slightly, and then the film goes off. You're thinking, so there could be enough.
That's, but it's
right,
a possessed
what's strange
car.
About that is, why has no one ever remade Christine?
Good question. I mean, it's probably going to happen.
It's open to being remade.
Yeah, but maybe there's a lot of restriction with the what you can do with a car other than run people over, gas them out.
Two deaths straight away.
Okay.
When it's being made, at the very beginning, it's on the production line. Some guy's just like tinkering with it, and the bonnet comes down on his hands and breaks his hands.
That's probably what I'm thinking of then.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think it's possessed cars. There's nothing like it been since. I mean, they've never actually done a possessed car.
No, they've not, because a lot of people think that the car that James Dean died in was possessed. Haunted. There's something wrong with that car, because it just followed so much bad luck with that, associated with that one car. Yeah. But yeah, Christine, it's a good film.
Yeah.
It just feels a little bit made for TV.
It's not as memorable for me as I'd say the other films that I've
seen. Is this the start of his decline, do you think? He's starting to get a little bit more money and
but then he did make Starman, and I do remember Starman, and it's a romantic film. It's not his usual thing.
Mm.
Starman, because I couldn't even remember that John Carpenter made this movie. But have you seen Starman?
No.
Starman is a film about a widower who widow.
A widower.
No, she's lost her husband.
Yeah.
And she's still in mourning, still in grief. And this alien lands on the planet. It arrives at her house, and it needs to assume the identity of a human being. So it assumes her the identity of her husband. And the film is kind of like a romantic adventure drama, where she thinks her husband's come back. And he's literally just unable to. It's the first time he's been on Earth, so everything is brand new to him. He's like a child. And the story is basically he's trying to get back to his ship, where he was where he crash landed, and he's going to be eventually gets taken back up again. So it's kind of like Ghost in a way at the end.
Yeah.
Where she's kind of like saying goodbye, I love you, and he kind of gets it. He understands it. So the journey for him is to kind of realize what it is to be human through her.
Right.
And it's Karen Allen, Jeff Bridges. It's a nice little cast. It's got Martin. Oh, I thought I was going to say Martin Sheen then, but it's not. I don't think there's anybody else in this movie of note. Yeah, they're all people who you probably recognize the face but don't know the name.
Right. Okay.
But yeah, I think it was a cute romantic film, and for John Carpenter to do this was quite brave, I'd say, to do something
also,
that's a little bit low key.
Do you think he was trying to break into the mainstream a little bit more?
I don't think it was a mainstream movie either. I don't think it really had. It wasn't great appeal. It wasn't. It was just a small movie. It's a romantic film like Bridges of Madison County would be.
Right.
So I don't think he was intending to be anything other than just something different. Yeah, but
right.
Then I don't know. Maybe there is a underlining reason behind him making the film that's not necessarily his taste. Or his decision, or maybe he needed money so that he could then make Big Trouble in Little China,
which is what come next.
Yeah,
which is a great little film.
It's a fun film. It's probably the first time that I actually got into martial arts films.
Yeah,
I don't think I watched any martial arts film until this. I think this was on the television.
Right.
Martial arts films weren't really that huge on television.
Right. Well, I was brought up on Bruce Lee and Jackie Chan.
It was only because of this movie that I actually sought after Bruce Lee. Not so much Jackie Chan. I was more like, I was the Bruce Lee, Chuck Norris.
So your films are nowhere near done as well as Jackie Chan's films are.
Bruce Lee is more of a, he's more of an Art Nouveau kind of a filmmaker, actor in his films. It's all about being on his own.
Well, a lot of his stuff was directed by Lo Wei and...
Yeah.
They made no sense at all. Because when he was fighting like a gymnasium full of people, it's like he'd be fighting one person, there's all these people in the background just moving from side to side.
Waiting to go.
And then when he's beating one person, but in a Jackie Chan film, everyone's on him.
Yeah.
And he has to fight all of them.
That's the difference. I think if I'd have been brought up with a Jackie Chan film, I probably would have had a completely different appreciation. But because I didn't know about the Jackie Chan films, I thought that was kind of, it was showboating. It's exhibition filming. And that was okay for me. Enter the Dragon was probably the only one where there was an exception, because that's actually in an arena of competition.
Yeah.
But yeah, like you say, all the other films, they literally could just take him on and get rid of the guy, get rid of him straight away.
Yeah.
But they all just wait.
Well,
dancing up one foot to the other, waiting to muscle in, like, oh, I'm ready to go, tag team, let's go.
And then one of those guys surely would be thinking, right, you beat everybody up, I'm not even bothering.
But,
with one punch to down, so I'm gonna, I'm fine here, mate. You do your thing.
These generic Chinese actors that just come for the day will pay you, and you have no liability if he does hit you. You know, you're not gonna have to ask for money.
Yes. Well, you know, Jackie Chan was in Enter the Dragon. Yeah, he was one of the guys, one of the henchmen at the end when he's escaping.
No way.
Yeah, and he hits him with a staff, but he actually hit him with the staff. Probably clocked him in the eye. Jackie went down, carried on acting, because he's Jackie, and he's solid. And then after they finished the scene, Bruce was like, oh my God, I'm so sorry. And he's like, it's fine.
Yeah, that's great. I didn't realise there was a kind of connection between the two.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
I thought they were literally just two separate.
Jackie Chan was a stuntman and worked on Way of the Dragon. And when he kicks that guy through the doors and he goes flying across to that garden and then just lands on the other side, that's Jackie Chan.
Yeah.
At that point, that was the biggest jump anyone had ever done in Hong Kong.
Nice.
And all Jackie did was got one side of the room, legged it, and jumped out the window and just went flying and hit. And apparently after he'd done it, he's like, let me try it one more time. And Bruce was like, I like this kid. I want him in my next film kind of thing, you know.
Brilliant. But yeah.
But anyway, Big Trouble in Little China. But it's like, it's fantasy. We've got Kurt Russel again, who plays this really funny idiot.
Now from here on, it gets pretty normal. Offices, storerooms, a nice false front. I count to three.
Hold on for a while.
You open that door, we move out.
Everybody, you got that.
Ready? Follow the leader. One, two, three. She may be trapped.
You know, he thinks he's like this big, sharp guy, but he's not. He keeps making mistakes all the time, getting things wrong.
And what I noted was that in all of the films before, John Carpenter had kept his dialogue quite low.
Yeah.
Not too much. He didn't talk too much in Escape. He didn't talk a lot in
The Thing.
Yeah. His characters were a lot more moody, quiet, isolated. This guy, he's just literally big mouth.
Yeah.
He's a truck driver. He likes to talk.
Yeah, he talks the shit. Then he hasn't got anything to back up, and he's always making mistakes. But he's such a good comic actor, I think, Kurt Russel, especially in this.
Yeah, he's comfortable with himself in this movie.
And he's
more than anything.
Yeah, and he has such conviction in what he says. Like, there was that part where the bad guy, what's his name in it? Lo Pang, is it? He gives this big dialogue about why he's having to do that, and Kurt Russel, who's tied to that wheelchair, just leans forward and is like, are you insane? Is that your problem? I'll clearly doesn't make you laugh, but every time, me and my mate Matt, where we watched it loads when we were at college, and just him made us so happy and just loved that character.
You got a tongue, Dave, master yourself. Go off and rule the universe from beyond the grave.
Indeed!
Or check into a psycho war, whichever comes first, huh?
Did you used to pretend to be him?
No, yeah. Never pretended to be him, but yeah, I just kind of loved it.
Yeah?
Yeah, I loved him.
You didn't emulate it, because I think I probably would have emulated characters as a kid. I used to
pretend I was Street Hawk. So I'd dress up all in black, put my black hood on and get on my bike and just drive up my dad's driveway and then do a jump like I was coming out of the thing in Street Hawk.
That's funny. I used to think I was Martin Sheen in Apocalypse Now. Wow. I used to cycle around with music blaring. And I'm
did
like,
you?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I used to think I was Marlon Brando at the same time. I'd just sit in the corner and be broody.
Ooh, there's a fly in my head.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, he's not exactly the kind of a hero. I mean, at the time, in 1986, you know, all the kids were into He-Man.
Mm.
And all these little action men characters, but
it didn't do well. It got panned.
No,
I don't think people got it.
No, because they didn't get the tongue in cheek aspect of it.
Yeah.
They probably were confused by the fusion between America and China.
Yeah, they probably thought,
well, this is, they're in China, but they're not.
Yeah,
why? You know, but they didn't get the, especially European audiences probably don't understand Little China.
Yeah.
As being a district of an American city.
Absolutely.
So I'm wondering if that affected things a little bit, because it is a departure for John Carpenter to make something that's, funnily enough, a little bit less mainstream.
Yeah, and it's essentially a comedy.
With more money.
Yeah, you know. I think if this had took off, maybe his career would have gone a different direction, and he'd probably get spoke about in the same vein as the Spielbergs do.
Yeah.
But because it bombed, didn't do anything and got panned, it built up a cult following like these films tend to do.
They all do.
But I think this really sort of predicted what he'd do next, like Prince of Darkness.
Yeah, I think he went...
A lot of people say this is his last great film.
Prince of Darkness, which is Donald Pleasence, who... You got to say that John Carpenter does rely on the people that he can trust. He keeps his friends close and reuses them. He doesn't just play the field.
Yeah.
So if he knows that they do the job, he is evil, he is real, it is awakening, so it is evil. Very dark.
Yeah. Well, a research team finds a mysterious cylinder in a deserted church. If opened, it could mean the end of the world. There you go. Pretty dark.
Yeah.
I'm going to be honest, I've never seen it.
I have never seen it either, and that looks like that guy from Big Trouble in Little China.
Yep.
So I think that, but... I haven't seen Prince of Darkness either, so maybe that's probably the reason. Maybe it's just not it's not as accessible as perhaps his other films are. And then you've got They Live.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Oh. Yeah.
Which, back in 1988, is...
A very forward-thinking...
Well, yeah,
satire.
It is a satire, and it's in the vein of 1984.
Yeah.
The other one. You said it just before you left the house last week. They Live is is in the same vein as 1984, but an American perspective on consumerism.
Absolutely, and like in governmental lies and injustice and stuff. But with this very B movie vibe to it. Like,
yeah.
Not very well acted. Cheesy dialogue.
Yeah.
But all.
It's kind of like he's gone backwards in a way, but done on purpose. And
yeah.
And people have got to be able to get it. This is probably why he struggled to hit the mainstream, because he was trying things that. Like, we try things. We try to be subversive to audiences by having you opening a package for 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Some people wouldn't get that.
Yeah. And it seems in some ways a big fuck you to Hollywood.
Yeah, he doesn't want to conform. He doesn't want to be mainstream, and he wants to carry on pushing the envelope. And I think this was one of those envelope-pushing films that just struggled to go anywhere. I mean, it did all right, this film?
I'm not sure. I don't. Again, it's got like a massive cult following now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's full of classic lines and stuff.
Starring Roddy Piper.
Yes.
And
he was a wrestler, wasn't he?
He was a wrestler in the WWF, and he continued to do competition until about 2010, I think.
Right.
When it was WWE, and he's just a typical wrestler look about him.
Yeah.
Kind of like a Mickey Rourke in his acting.
Yeah.
As well, later years, but yeah, he did a fair job. He's typical Stephen King kind of a character, where you know, because Stephen King films tend to have actors who aren't necessarily on at the top of their pyramid.
Yeah,
but they do okay.
Yeah,
that's a typical kind of Stephen King TV movie type of appeal. It's from the short story. I can't remember what the name of it is, but I can tell you that, you know, Shepard Fairey, who created the Obey poster, the cult Obey poster. He's kind of like the Banksy type of guy who makes posters.
Okay.
He did Obama, the Audacity of Hope, kind of hope poster. He created all those things. He was inspired by this film to create that Obey.
Right. Okay.
And his name was Shepard Fairey.
Right. You've got some facts here.
I've got some facts.
Hit me with the facts.
Do you want some more facts?
Yeah, hit me with the facts.
Okay, Meg Foster played Evil Lynn in Masters of the Universe. She's in this film.
Yeah.
And she has the most bizarre eyes.
She does.
And they... Yeah. The years have not been kind to her. She doesn't look like that anymore. She looks quite frightening. The communicators that the guards use are the PKE meters in Ghostbusters. Did you know that?
I did not know that.
There's a scene where they're kind of like in a corridor looking for. I think they're looking for him.
Yeah.
The PKE meters. Yeah, they use those.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, there's that little fact. Often cited by British author David Icke as John Carpenter's best film, and
well,
I wonder why.
Yeah, you can see David Icke getting on board with this very well. I'll be honest with you, I started a website that was called weareone.com.
Did you?
It was all about governmental conspiracies, all that sort of stuff, and I used all the sort of iconography out of They Live as the backdrop of the website.
Yeah, you should have just made it like the black and white thing, and every time you hover over it, it goes Obey.
Oh,
you can do hoverovers now, so
I'm not that good at.
I can do that.
Like that.
Oh, do you know what? That sounds like a good idea. Sounds like fun. It's the longest alley fight. I was sitting there watching that alley fight for ages. The between Frank and a wrestler. Dude.
Yeah,
names escape me. But that alley fight was rehearsed for 3 weeks. They shot the film over 3 months, I think.
Yeah,
8 weeks schedule. So it was quite a short schedule. But 3 weeks of that was rehearsing the alley fight, so it was a big deal, and the whole premise of that alley fight was for him to wear the glasses. The idea of the film They Live is that we should actually say that it's about the world is full of subliminal messages, and when you put on these dark sunglasses, you actually see what is actually coming to you as a subliminal message. Every single magazine, for example, is just white with black writing on it, with words that are kind of like trying to tell you to
consume,
obey, use money is God. If you look at money, printed money, it's got money. This is your God on it. All the posters have you know, marry and reproduce written on the side.
So it's very Orwellian.
Orwellian, and there are some people who are kind of like in charge, the rich and the conservative,
the
basically
elite.
The elite. I'd say they're all Democrat. They're not Democratic. They're Republicans.
Yeah.
I think there's definitely a slant of political insight here, that, and they're all aliens.
Yeah.
And the makeup is incredible.
It is. It's great. Yeah, it's a really good sort of allegory, isn't it?
Yeah. It's well edited as well. I mean, the glasses come down and everything's there, and the glasses come off and everything's normal. And it's very well conceived, very technically proficient film.
Mm.
But then different. It's not your typical, like you say. It was very low budget kind of feel. Very satirical, but it doesn't feel like it fits. The intelligence of it doesn't fit.
I think that's the problem, isn't it?
Yeah.
So it's like on one hand you've got this incredibly intelligent social satire, and on the other hand you've got this B movie acting, clunky dialogue, and the two don't quite marry together.
Like the Spice Girls.
Like the Spice Girls. But unlike Spice World the movie, which is the perfect film.
Okay, so the brave ending involving a sex scene, that's kind of like an odd ending, the most weird ending, you know, because it literally just says everybody's just, you know, the everything's just carrying on as normal.
Yeah,
the Republicans are reproducing, and there's a shot for boobs for no reason. And I think now this is my theory, that he was told that he wasn't allowed to have boobs in this movie. So
right.
he put that shot in the end for absolutely boob reason only.
Right. But the ending being that it just carries on.
Yeah.
Is very 1984, because the end of 1984, he realises that he loves Big Brother. All the torture he's endured has made him love Big Brother. He's now just like everybody else.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
And that's the end. So it is his Big Brother. I guess. His 1984.
Yeah, screw you, this is it.
What year was it made?
1988.
That would have been nice. Never mind. Let's pretend it was made in 1984.
Yeah, that would have been good.
So but then, really, after that, what have we got?
Yeah, but basically, there's one thing as well. The character Roddy Piper, he flips his finger at the situation.
Yeah.
At the end, which is exactly the same thing that Henry Fonda did in at the end of Future World.
Oh, of course.
He leaves the resort, just flips his finger, and that's it.
Yeah.
Which, in some cuts of Future World, they actually did that, because certain countries didn't accept the finger. So they did the old...
I've never liked a person who won't accept the finger.
Yeah. Okay, so after that, we're not going to go to that one just yet. We've got...
In the mouth of... Oh, we've got body bags.
Memoirs of an Invisible Man, come on.
Is that the Chevy Chase film?
That is a John Carpenter film? I had no idea. Yes, the Chevy... I had no idea.
I didn't.
I'm gutted, because that's an incredible film.
Yeah.
I love that film.
92.
And this is his mainstream. This is his... Okay. Because if They Live didn't do well, then obviously he had the pressure.
Yeah.
To do something that was mainstream. Sam Neill, I didn't know he was in that. But it's a great film.
Because Sam Neill's is in At the Mouth of Madness.
Yes, he is. So there he goes.
Which is his take on The Mountains of Madness, the H.P. Lovecraft book.
And is that next? Body Bag is, of course...
TV movie.
And The Mouth of Madness. Okay, yeah, so that's... I actually saw that when it was probably out on video rental,
yeah.
So I haven't seen it since then. But there's a lot of...
And then we've got Village of the Damned,
which is
that again. That feels very made for TV.
And it's very unusual casting.
Christopher Reeve, Kirstie Alley.
Yeah, because people you wouldn't expect to see in this movie as well. Meredith Salinger's in it as well. She's the woman who doesn't get pregnant with the demon, with the alien child.
Yeah.
Basically, the film is about populating this village, this town. Sorry, with alien beings. And when they all grow up, they've all got white hair, and they all basically, the whole town becomes pregnant at the same time. Unfortunately, Meredith Salinger's character miscarriages, and she drinks herself to suicide, I think. I think she gets killed. It's an okay film. Mark Hamill plays the Reverend.
Oh, of course he does.
It's an okay film. But it kind of felt very Children of the Corn. It was trying to...
Because we look at the films after this now.
Yeah.
We've got...
Yeah, Escape from L.A., which...
didn't do well.
Yeah, it was... Kurt Russel, obviously, was probably not doing a lot at that time as well.
Yeah, but it's not a great film. It's on now, actually. But so it's okay. Is that Peter Fonda?
Yeah, Peter Fonda.
But it's not quite as good as the first one. It loses a lot of its...
It doesn't have as much snake bite.
Yeah, good
as
one.
The first one.
Yeah, he's about to do it, when they go surfing through the city. It's just dreadful.
This is actually the worst scene ever in the John Carpenter. I think this has to be the worst conceived scene in the John Carpenter film, I'm afraid. It is ridiculous.
Yeah, and then we had Vampires after that, which again was okay.
Mm-hmm.
They had Cheryl Fenn out of Twin Peaks in it.
Oh, okay. Well, that's at least... I had the opportunity of watching that. James Woods, of course. Yeah. So I never actually...
It's okay. It's not a bad film at all, you know.
Fact that it's called Vampires, it's kind of like... Feels like it's... it's like a film that just says Dracula.
Yeah.
It's like, is it really just going to be...
And then we've got Ghosts of Mars, which isn't good at all.
It's... the sets in that were just... Mars is red. Okay, get over it.
Yeah.
It's not red. Anybody could make a film about Mars. If they could make a film about Mars where the surface of the Mars is the color that it's supposed to be, the same color as the moon.
Yeah.
Did you know that?
I didn't.
No, they colorized it because everybody had preconceptions of what Mars' surface looked like. So when they actually shot the first real photographs of Mars, people thought that nobody would believe that they were actually photos from Mars unless they were colorized to red. And
lying to you.
Yeah, this is the big thing, which I'm surprised that that John Carpenter didn't just say, you know what, Mars is not red.
But he just doesn't. These films just don't seem like they were.
He's not even there,
just
is he?
Sort of servicing them, I guess. Just
he's not there.
Them.
He's no? not in. I don't think he wanted to be a director.
Yeah, maybe just,
anymore.
He's just going through the motions. He's kind of fed up of it.
Yeah, because I don't really see him in these movies.
No. You've not seen The Ward, have you?
No.
The last film, 2010.
Yeah. What's the first thing you remember? Fire.
What's your name?
Kristen.
Welcome to The Ward. Your new home.
Why am I here? You can't get them to tell you anything. Sometimes they take people away and they don't come back.
If I were you, I'd watch out, new girl.
There's a ghost in here.
I'm sure you believe you saw what you say.
I'm not crazy. She's the last one that got out. She's one of us, but she's gone now. And now she's going to kill us all.
You've got to deal with them.
We have to get out of here. Get her in a straitjacket. That wasn't so bad, was it?
Amber Heard's in it, who I find incredibly attractive, so that helps. But it was, again, it was an okay film. It's not amazing, but there's a few little Carpenter moments in there.
There's nobody in the cast who I recognise.
That was part of the beauty of it. You never knew. That sort of made you didn't know who was going to go.
You know what I mean? Yeah.
And it has some quite creepy moments in it, but...
Okay, so overall, if you look at John Carpenter's career, he's always been a director. He's always wanted to be the director that's true to his own vision.
Yeah.
He's always been in control of his vision.
That's it for the most part.
He likes to have final cut.
Mm.
There aren't many director's cuts where he's, you know, where the studio's done one and he's done his own. I think everything has pretty much been the way that he wanted it.
Mm.
Probably up until probably Memoirs of the Invisible Man, where pressure started to build up, and he was probably no longer allowed to have as much control because studios were more about individual production. Producers wanted to be billed, and
yeah, I suppose the '70s and the '80s, you didn't really feel like the production, the companies were trying to, the studios were having too much of a say.
Yeah, they were
trusting, but then as maybe Dave starts to say, no, we want this, because they start to think, this is huge money.
Yeah.
We want blockbusters, we want this, we want that, and it's not about that. Maybe that's why he just starts to go, well, forget it.
But if you think about it, the 60s was kind of like the breakdown of the studio system, and then all these different production companies started, American Zoetrope, Canon, Orion Pictures, and American Independent Films. All these different studios came out, and there were lots and lots. So basically, there were production companies that literally made their own films. Then what happened was, this Time Warner started to buying them, Paramount started to buy them, other companies like Universal started to buy all these little tiny and incorporate them as kind of like, you're going to be making these kind of films for us. These guys are going to make these films. We're going to liquidize this company and make this into this. Dimension Films came about because of liquidization of lots of different production companies, and they literally said, "Well, but we're going to be in control." So that's what happened in the late 90s. Big studios were taking control of all these multiple thousands of little companies,
right?
And that's what I think it was at that time that he started to get jaded. So I was looking into the idea of how the studio systems were working, and I think that's probably why, it's because of the monopolizing of studio, and because anybody could make any film in the 80s and 70s and 80s, and they were more independent than anything ever before. So I've got a feeling that it's because of that,
right?
Yeah,
well, I'd say like late 70s through the 80s,
it was a good time to make film.
He was brilliant. He's made some of my favourite films. And I think that should conclude our...
Do you miss him as a director now? Yeah, do you kind of that he was still...
If the news came on the wire that he was making a new film, I'd be very excited.
Yeah.
I'd be waiting for it to come out and hoping not to be disappointed. The Ward didn't disappoint me. I wasn't blown away by it.
Yeah.
But he didn't disappoint me at all. But I'd like him to make another film, come back with it.
Yeah,
but maybe he won't. Maybe he's just happy to drink whiskey and play music now.
To be honest, I think that's all that matters, really.
Yeah, whiskey and music. Let's end it there. See you next week, everyone.
See you next week. Watch John Carpenter movies.
Yes.
You know, it's hard to do a scary film. Horror and scary movies are a lot like comedy. It's all timing.
Were there any particular movies or scenes that gave little Johnny nightmares growing up? Anything you can recall?
The original Thing from Another World scared me. The Fly scared me.
Mm. Let's talk about Halloween. Now, from what I understand, the budget was minuscule.
I got a call from a distributor saying, well, I want to make a movie. I've got $300,000. I want to make a movie about babysitter murderers. Because he figured every girl in America, everybody is babysat. So what if some killer is stalking them?
Now, you have a Jamie Lee. Obviously, she's got a famous pedigree.
She just had a whole lot of talent, and she was really gung-ho to do it. She wanted to do a movie, and she could really scream.
Honestly, what does this guy Myers have against Halloween? I mean, what is it?
Michael Myers is just a stand-in for all evil. He's a cipher. He's not a real thing, a person. They've made him a real person in the sequels, but he's not. He just a stand-in. That's what makes him so scary.
All right, now I want to talk about The Thing.
The Thing was received negatively in terms of the reviews and a lot of the audience because it was so in your face. The monster was just, there he was, right in the light. There's an old cliche in Hollywood, you're not supposed to do that. You're supposed to keep him hidden in the shadows. Mm-hmm. Well, I just put it out in the open.
Which of these scenes from these two classic horror films, are there any particular ones that you can put your finger on that you're proudest of?
Well, like we were talking about in The Thing, I think the blood test scene is my favorite.
I thought you'd feel that way, Gary. You were the only one that could have got to that blood. We'll do you last.
In Halloween, there are several moments that I'm really proud of, especially because we didn't have any money. When Jamie Lee comes out of her room, she's just seen some dead, her dead friends, and she goes into a corner. And she's sort of cowering and sniveling. And you become aware, very slowly, that Michael Myers, the shape, is standing right behind her. Well, Dean Cundey put a light really high above him on a dimmer, and then just brought it up really slowly. But you have to bring it up just as it's being exposed to the film, the audience is seeing it. I'm happy with that. The scarier, the better. Everybody loves to be in the dark together and scream and have a good time.
You know, I'm going to take this opportunity to let the people know how they can contact our friends at Frame by Frame. They do that podcast
thing. You know, two guys, yeah, they do the podcast, okay? So
yeah,
how?
They're nice. They're like a forest, which is a beautiful thing.
Exactly. And so if you want to do the communicating thing, you know, the social networking thing.
Yeah, you can you can tweet those guys at FrameByFrame78. If you'd like to go to their website, that will be www.roastedportions.com.
You don't need to do the www. It's implied that it's going to be the World Wide Web.
But people need to know that.
Okay, just go to roastedportions.com, okay? You go down on the right-hand side, you've got the social connections. You can talk to the people who do the show. You can even talk to the people who made that movie, you know, CACO3.
Who'd want to talk to those mooks?
I don't know, they made a pretty interesting movie, right?
Well,
it was in black and white.
Yeah, black and white. I like that.
We like black and white, because, and there's also some trees in that movie, too.
Oh, trees, it's like being in a forest, which is a beautiful thing.
Other connections, you can really get to know these people on YouTube as well, and if you want to comment on their podcast, I urge you to do that. Okay?
Yeah, I think it is a proper, really nice thing if people want to start contacting these guys.
Subscribe to them and comment. I mean, it's just polite, you know.
Also, you can email them at framebyframe78@gmail.com.
That's it. I think that's everything wrapped up, so.
Hey, I'm gonna go and plant a tree somewhere.
Okay, you go plant some trees.
I'm gonna go and plant a tree.
I'm gonna go tweet.
You tweet, I'll plant a tree.
It's us, we're out of here.